Chief Program Officer with the Alzheimer's Association, and it's an absolute pleasure for me to be here at my first Alzheimer's Association Northern California, Northern Nevada conference, and so I'm delighted to be with you today as we, I got a round of applause, isn't that great? As we continue with our morning presentation here, you know, I have to echo what my wonderful colleague and mentor, Dr. Edgerly, said this morning about how wonderful it is when we plan these conferences. While I'm new to the area, I've been with the Alzheimer's Association for 16 years, and we see this growth, right, year after year. But it also always reminds me of that increased need that we need to meet, and that while it's wonderful that there's more of us here year after year, it just reminds all of us that are in the community doing this work that we have much, much more work to do. And so this days like today are the way we come together to provide great information, education, and support for those of you living with Alzheimer's disease, caring or in a personal or professional way. So I'm delighted to be here. I also get the privilege of introducing our next speaker, Dr. Frank Longo. And I want to let everybody know on the center of their table this morning were some notepads that, full disclosure, we stole from our wonderful partners here because we forgot the pack of index cards. So thank you to all of those that gave us the notepads from their sponsor tables. For you to write a question, we're going to be doing Dr. Longo's going to talk for about 50 minutes or so, and then we're going to do a great little Q&A panel at the end. So we want you to think about what questions you have for him, and then we'll be collecting them right around the end of his presentation. So let me tell you about our next speaker. Dr. Frank Longo is professor and chairman at the Department of Neurology and Neurological Sciences at Stanford University and serves as on the advisory committee for the Stanford Neurosciences Institute. He completed his neurology training in the Department of Neurology at UCSF, where he also served as professor and vice chair. Since 2006, he has been the chair of the Department of Neurology and Neurological Sciences at Stanford. While at Stanford, Dr. Longo has led the recruitment of close to 80 faculty and has overseen the initiation of further development of major clinical programs in Alzheimer's, stroke, epilepsy, Parkinson's, headache, and other neurological disease areas. In the area of research, Dr. Longo has led a major research expansion in Stanford neurology, with the department recently ranking among the top five in the U.S. in NIH funding. Within his own research efforts, he is one of those rare physician scientists who has advanced an approach starting at basic mechanism through preclinical trials and into human trials. With support from the NIH and generous donations, he and his team have pioneered an entirely new pharmaceutical approach for the treatment of Alzheimer's disease and other neurodegenerative diseases. He founded Pharmatrophics with his wife, Anne Longo, as CEO, a company focused on the commercial development of treatments for Alzheimer's and other diseases. In 2015, Dr. Longo was the recipient of the inaugural Goods Prize for Excellence in Alzheimer's Drug Discovery from the Alzheimer's Drug Discovery Foundation. And in 2016, his lead drug was featured on the cover of Time magazine. So an absolute expert that we have for you here today. It is my pleasure to welcome to the stage Dr. Frank Longo.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you, Claire, for that wonderful introduction, and welcome everybody. We're looking forward to discussing with you the latest on dementia prevention, care, and treatment. I'd like to thank all of our colleagues at the Alzheimer's Association, Claire Day, who's relatively new, and Allison Rosen, who's not at the association. She's at Stanford in the VA, but she really does a lot of the hard work each year, she and her team putting this conference together. And then Pauline Martinez at the Alzheimer's Association, who had the very difficult job of getting us to turn in our talks. So thank you for your patients. I'd also like to acknowledge my colleagues from Stanford at our table outside there for information on our Alzheimer's research program at Stanford. We'll be speaking about that later. So my goal in the next 50 minutes or so is to bring each of you up to date on what dementia is all about from a 2017 in May perspective, how Alzheimer's relates to the other dementias, the current thoughts on prevention. Every week this changes, so we'll bring you right up to date on that. Current thoughts on our existing drugs that we have, and then what's in the pipeline in terms of therapeutic trials that bring hope to our families and patients. And then we'll leave plenty of time, about 20 minutes, for questions, discussions, controversial areas that you can ask whatever you want. My comments today are guided by two perspectives, really. I work as a neurologist in our Memory Disorders Center at Stanford, and so my families and patients are continuously educating me by their thoughts and their questions. So it's the common questions that my colleagues and I get at Stanford that guide much of what I drill down to. And I love the challenge. Once in a while, somebody will ask me something about a treatment I don't know about, and the first thing I do is become an expert on it. And then I'm also guided by my group's own work on developing a treatment for Alzheimer's disease. I'll share that adventure with you. I'm guided by being on NIH study sections and all kinds of foundations across the country that are continuously getting the latest ideas and proposals. So my goal is to put all that together to bring you up to date and give you a chance to ask questions about it. Okay, where are we headed? Let's define what we're talking about first. We'll be talking about Alzheimer's quite a bit, but we're going to be talking about dementia. Dementia is a broad term, meaning that the person has a loss of cognitive function, generally in two or more areas of cognitive function, memory plus language or memory plus something else, that's severe enough to cause a loss of day-to-day function. That's the definition of dementia. There are many different causes of dementia. The most common cause, about two-thirds of the cases of dementia, is Alzheimer's. So many people will ask, what's the difference between dementia and Alzheimer's? Now you know. Dementia, a broad term. Alzheimer's, one of the many causes of dementia, accounts for about two-thirds. What are the second and third most common causes of dementia? There are two, and they kind of go back and forth on which one's second or third. It doesn't make that much difference. Vascular dementia, where the small blood vessels in the brain are affected by disease, and there's an issue with blood flow to the brain, that can cause a dementia. We call it vascular dementia. And then Lewy body dementia, and that's where the patient presents with some combination of some Parkinson's type of features, plus a cognitive impairment. They don't have a formal Parkinson's disease. They have sort of what I call a blend of Alzheimer's and some Parkinsonian features. That's called Lewy body dementia. That's the other common one. Many of the areas of research that are talk about Alzheimer's are very relevant, though, to vascular dementia and Lewy body dementia. So since sometimes we're putting them all together, other times there may be treatments that work better for one than the other. So today we're dealing with a broad spectrum of dementia, but we're also largely focusing on Alzheimer's disease. So that's the definition. So in the image here, we have the two hallmarks in the brain that occur in Alzheimer's disease, the development of amyloid plaques and tau tangles. And amyloid plaques consist of a fragment of a protein. This protein is called the amyloid precursor protein. It has a normal job. We don't quite understand what its normal job is completely. But for some reason, that protein gets cut up into fragments by enzymes. Those fragments glom together and form what you see as those brown clumps in the brain. Now, these amyloid fragments are very toxic to the connections between the neurons in our brain. So we have 100 billion neurons in our brain. Each one can have 1,000 or 10,000 connections. We call those connections synapses. Synapses is a very important term in the field of dementia because it's those synapses that are the connections, and when we start to lose those synapses, we lose our cognition. The synapses for memory are particularly delicate, and that's why as we age, we lose memory function and we lose it particularly in dementia. So these amyloid fragments are toxic to those synapses. They make them malfunction, and then they're so toxic that those synaptic connections eventually even die and disappear. The tau protein is the second protein. It's also a normal protein in the brain that does have a normal job of stabilizing the neurons, the nerve cells. But for some reason in Alzheimer's disease, that tau protein acquires an abnormal shape. It causes it to clump into clusters, and those clumps of tau are also very toxic to those synaptic connections. So those are two big famous hallmarks in the Alzheimer brain. More recently, people feel that inflammation, the immune system in a way attacking the brain, is another important part of this disease. So on the bottom of this image here, I review really the basic spectrum that many of us are going through. We start off with age-related cognitive impairment. It's important to understand the spectrum because the treatments are oriented at different points along the spectrum. What age does age-related cognitive impairment begin? If there's anybody in here age 30 or over, you might know about it. It might be relevant to you. That's when it starts. And what happens at about this age is that our efficiency and speed of our short-term memory aren't quite of what it was, say, when we were 22 or 19, for example. Generally, it's not significant functionally, other than in, you know, very rare fields. If you want to be a superstar mathematician or computer software programmer, hopefully you started before age 30, for example. And most of us do okay with the age-related cognitive impairment. Our kids may not think so, but I think we do okay. And then many of us, though, in our 60s or 70s, will go on to develop mild cognitive impairment. You really need to understand the definitions of these terms because our trials are based on these terms. So-called MCI, mild cognitive impairment. What is that? That's when a patient comes to a memory clinic, like the Stanford Memory Clinic. They or their family or their friends or their coworkers are noticing some issues in cognition, often memory, but it could be other forms of cognition. And we test them carefully. We have a whole group of PhD neuropsychologists that do a 3 or 4 hour test battery when someone has a cognitive complaint, and they get the results back in the separate cognitive domains. There's memory, there's visual spatial, there's language, the ability to multitask, we call it executive function, et cetera. And you're scored in a percentile for your gender, age, and education. So you may be at the 50th percentile, you may be really doing really well at the 99th percentile, or you may be down at the 5th percentile. So if you're 1.5 or 2 standard deviations below what would be expected for your age, gender, and education, we will say that you have a significant cognitive impairment beyond that explained by age. But if your day-to-day function is still largely intact, remember the definition of dementia. If your day-to-day function is intact, you don't meet the definition of a dementia, but we'll diagnose you as having an MCI or mild cognitive impairment, sort of that in-between zone. Now, that's a serious diagnosis to get. There are a couple implications here. If we tell you that you have MCI or mild cognitive impairment, what's the underlying cause? Many of those patients will have an early stage of Alzheimer's is the underlying cause. Some might have an early stage of vascular dementia as the underlying cause. We can't really tell you exactly what your underlying cause will be, but it does raise concern because many of these will be at an early stage of Alzheimer's. Most will go on to get worse, unfortunately. If you've been diagnosed with MCI over the subsequent 5 years, one has about a 35 or 40% chance of progressing on to an actual dementia. And most often that dementia is Alzheimer's, could end up being vascular dementia or Lewy body disease. But some people stay stable at MCI for more than 5 years. They don't change. And a very small number, unfortunately, actually can get better. And we don't know why they get better, but it's a very small number. So that's one of our big clinical challenges is guidance to a patient and family. What's the future if you have MCI? Many of the trials now we'll be talking about are shifting from actual dementia to earlier stages, and they're enrolling people with mild cognitive impairment or MCI. And then finally, as I mentioned, many people with MCI will go on to progress to an actual dementia, most often Alzheimer's. What are the risk factors for each of us? This is relevant to all of us. We'll talk about genetics, lack of physical exercise. We'll look at the data of whether exercise is helpful or how helpful it might be. So-called Western diet seems to be a factor. Medical conditions, especially hypertension, diabetes, raise the risks for dementia. Sleep apnea, we'll look at some of the recent studies there. This is, you know, short delays in breathing from heavy snoring or airway obstruction during the night where the oxygen level goes way down. And more recently, you may have seen this in the news about 6 months ago, chronic use of anticholinergic medications. These are medications that interfere with one of the systems in the brain called the cholinergic system. It's one of the neurotransmitter systems in the brain important for memory and other functions. And these medications include Benadryl, antihistamine, you're probably familiar with. Paxil and Elavil are two of our antidepressants. And Ditropan is one of the bladder medications. This study showed that people that are on these medications for long periods, 5 years or more typically, are at an increased risk, two or threefold, of coming down with a dementia. And we can theorize why that may be. I think for me as a clinician, the take-home message there is that if I thought I were at some increased risk for getting a dementia, we'll talk about that, what that means more. And if I had a choice between antidepressants and a few were about equally effective, I might ask my psychiatrist or my physician to say, can we be on one that's not does not have anticholinergic properties? Similarly, for bladder medications, we have a handful to pick from. I might ask my primary care physician or my urologist, can we try one of the bladder medications that don't get in the brain? Because the older ones go to the brain, like Ditropan. The newer ones don't go to the brain. So I would educate my caregivers if I were needing to use one of these medications. Let's jump into the genetics. We have two categories here. We have what we call late onset or sporadic Alzheimer's. This is about 98% of the situation. It's the most common version of Alzheimer's, where dementia starts after age 65. And it runs intermittently, it doesn't run straight in a family. And that's as opposed to what we call familial Alzheimer's disease, it's less than 2% of all patients with Alzheimer's. The dementia starts in the 40s and 50s, so dramatically different time course, starting in the 40s or 50s versus typically more in the 60s and 70s for sporadic late onset Alzheimer's. The familial Alzheimer's is important because that's caused by one of three genes that if a parent has that gene, each child's at 50% risk for getting that disease. It's what we call an autosomal dominant gene. Each child's at 50% risk. And many of you probably read the book or saw the movie Still Alice, the main character there. Her mother, right, had Alzheimer's. She had the familial form, the early onset. And so the main character was at 50% risk. And we do provide genetic testing to see if you have that mutation. But for most of our patients and families, if they do have a parent with Alzheimer's, typically the dementia started after age 65, so we're typically not worried about this familial form, and we typically don't do that form of genetic testing, but you need to know about it. So we'll remain primarily confined today to the sporadic or common form, late onset Alzheimer's, and there's one gene, probably many genes affect it in some small way of whether you get this or not. But there's one main gene called APOE that has a particularly big effect on each of our risk of getting Alzheimer's disease. And this gene comes in three types, APOE2, E3, and E4. And I put that red circle around the E4 because that's the high risk gene. So for most of our genes, we each have two copies. So you might have a 2 and a 3, or a 2 and a 4, and if one or both of your copies are 4, you're at increased risk. Doesn't mean for sure that you'll get Alzheimer's, but you're at increased risk. So we can go through this little chart here and see how it affects us. Our lifetime risk, on average, if we live a normal lifespan, would be about 15% of us will get Alzheimer's. If we don't have the E4, say we're a 2-3 or a 2-2, we go down from 15% lifetime risk down to 9% lifetime risk. That's good. But if we have one copy of the E4, we double from a 15% risk to a 30% lifetime risk. So as a rule of thumb, if you or your friend or family or loved one have a parent
with Alzheimer's, you're at about double the risk of the person who doesn't have a parent with Alzheimer's. Now, what if, so this box on the left is no parent, no family history of Alzheimer's. What if one of your parents has Alzheimer's? Now we look at your ApoE results. If you don't have the four, 30% risk. If you have a parent with Alzheimer's plus the E4 high-risk gene, you're up to 45% lifetime risk. And if you're unlucky enough to have a parent with Alzheimer's plus both copies being E4, you're up to a 60% lifetime risk. It doesn't mean for sure you'll get Alzheimer's, but you see the risk here. This is particularly important this month to talk about because just in April, the FDA approved 23andMe providing genetic testing for the ApoE gene in their services. So most of you might be familiar with 23andMe. They started 8 or 10 years ago. So you spit into a plastic tube, mail it in, right? And then they analyze the DNA in the saliva, and then they post your results, you know, confidentially in a secure basis on their website. And they used to have about 300 somewhat medically relevant genes, ApoE being one. This was eight or 10 years ago, and you could get your ApoE results without going to your doctor or coming to our clinic, because we can also do this in our clinic through a blood test. But this way you could get your ApoE results directly. They call it direct-to-consumer genetic testing. But the FDA was concerned that about the appropriateness of people getting this potentially psychologically serious result outside of a medical care, outside of working with a genetic counselor, et cetera. So they forced 23andMe to stop this type of genetic testing. They stopped ApoE and a bunch of other medical genes. And then for the last 2 or 3 years, 23andMe has been working to satisfy the FDA requirements to report a small number of genes, including ApoE, and last month the FDA approved ApoE reports. So now you can, again, get your own ApoE results. So I have many people asking me about whether I've tested myself and whether I think it's a good idea to be tested. And this is a really important question because this will become more and more common for many of our genes, right? Not just this high-risk Alzheimer gene. So what are our thoughts? What are the pros and cons of getting yourself tested? Do you want to do this? And we can discuss this more during the questions, but just to briefly summarize potential upsides that people talk about. Well, if I had the high-risk gene, I'll start exercising. I've been thinking about going on a Mediterranean diet, and I'll do it for sure if I have the high-risk gene. What I'll do is I won't let it be on my medical record, and I'll go get long-term disability insurance now while I'm okay, and it won't cost as much, and I just won't tell anybody I got this testing done. That's a big part of the field. And in fact, one study was done. People that did this study and got the result back that they had the E4 high-risk gene had 5 times greater activity in buying long-term disability insurance. So people act off this. So those are some of the upsides that are argued. What are some of the downsides? Why would you not want to do this? Well, number one, and this is one I worry about quite a bit, maybe this sounded like a good idea today or this week, but next month or a year from now, when you wake up in the morning thinking that, okay, I've got this Alzheimer's gene, I wish I'd never found out, I can't stop thinking about it, this is affecting my life, should I share this with my spouse? Do I tell my kids? I feel terrible. Normally I share everything. Now I have the secret I'm not sharing. Will they treat me differently if I share it? You go through all of these things you never thought about before. Back in the early 90s, when I was on the faculty at UCSF, I started the first neurogenetics clinic on the West Coast. And so I had a lot of direct experience dealing with genetic testing, mainly for Huntington's disease and other neurodegenerative disease. I worked closely with a genetics counselor. We created a whole team. And sometimes that happened. People said, I can't put this genie back in the bottle. And so we had a very strict protocol where the first visit was fully informative, the upsides, the downsides. And then people would say, I want to get tested. We'd say, great, come back in a month. We forced a 1 month wait, and about half changed their mind during that month. So this is what we can do in a controlled clinical environment. But on 23andMe, you don't have all the support system. So potential downsides, worrying about it, I had one person get fired when they shared bad results with their boss at work. Illegal, but they'll do it anyway. There are countries, hasn't happened yet in the US, but when you're filling out an insurance form for disability or other forms of insurance, they'll ask you on that form, do you have any knowledge of that you're under increased risk for any kind of disease, right? So it puts you in an ethical conundrum. It's not in your medical records, you can lie, but do you want to do that? Can you live with that? And even if you're okay with that, if they find out, what's the issue there, right? What's the security of the 23andMe site? I don't know, right? So anyway, those are some of the cautionary things. We can talk about genetic testing more. And I put a note on this slide about Mike Gracious in our department at Stanford. He's taken advantage of this APOE high-risk situation. So there are individuals that have the worst luck possible. They, both of their APOEs are type 4, the high risk. Yet they make it into age 90 or above with their cognition being perfectly intact. Perfectly intact, even though they got dealt two E4 genes. So he thinks, his hypothesis is that they have another gene or two that give a powerful protection. And he's narrowed it down to a small number of genes that he thinks gives that powerful protection against getting Alzheimer's disease. And if he can understand that and create therapies based on that powerful, naturally occurring protection, maybe we'll have a whole new treatment approach. So that's a very hot area of research at Stanford and other places right now. How do we make a diagnosis of Alzheimer's if you send someone to the clinic or come in yourselves? Careful history. We'd like, as I mentioned, there are 20 or more causes of dementia. Many of them have different time courses, right? If the cognitive loss occurred over 2 months, that gives me a different list than if it occurred over 2 years. So I'm very sensitive to the time course here. The physical exam, we do a careful neurologic exam. We're looking for clues. If I can find a subtle Parkinsonian feature that generally other people can't see, but I can see it, I'm thinking about Lewy body dementia, right? Not just regular Alzheimer's disease, et cetera. I'm looking for clues on that neurologic exam. The cognitive exam I described, we want to quantitate things as best we can. We'll do an MRI scan. An MRI scan cannot detect Alzheimer's or Lewy body dementia or vascular dementia per se. We get it to rule other things out because a brain tumor can present as dementia. We don't want to miss a brain tumor. We can pull that out, right? A condition called hydrocephalus, too much fluid accumulating on the brain, that can present as a dementia. We can fix that, so we don't want to miss that. So the MRI is looking for other things, basically. And then we'll get a few blood tests. Vitamin B12, if those levels are low, it'll affect your memory function. If your thyroid levels are low, that'll affect cognitive function, so we're checking those. And we generally can be about 85% accurate in our initial diagnosis. We'll want to see you back to see if anything else comes up that suggests we might be wrong. 85% is not good enough in medicine, right? We want to be 99.9% accurate. And so at Stanford and other places, we're working on better brain scans, better blood tests. We need better technologies to get to that 99% accuracy. But this is why we want to see you back several times, just to make that accuracy go up. I think we are 100% effective in not missing something we can instantly fix, brain tumor, low B12, et cetera. Okay, and it's on cognitive testing, it's still paper and pencil, believe it or not, in 2017. People talk about shifting this to computer-based testing, but here's drawing a clock. We start with a blank paper. We'll ask you to put the face of the clock in, the numbers, make the hand say 245. There's a pretty decent performance for this patient when they started, and then every 6 months they came back, and you can see the deterioration that we get with visual spatial function, largely in this case. There's an MRI scan, Alzheimer's patient on top, normal patient on the bottom. You're not seeing much difference, because as I said, an MRI scan cannot detect Alzheimer's disease. If you have good eyes, you might see that brain on the top is slightly shrunken. Those black spaces around the sides are a little larger in the upper brain. That means the brain's a little bit shrunken. But our brains shrink with age, and that degree of shrinkage doesn't give us a clear diagnosis of what's going on here. Now, more recently, we have amyloid PET scans, which identifies amyloid accumulating in the brain. So a radioactive tracer is injected into the vein. It goes up to the brain, and it sticks to those amyloid plaques that you saw. And the more radioactive tracer there, the brighter, hotter the color is. So the reds and the yellows are indicating high levels of amyloid binding, and the cooler colors, the blue, are lower levels of amyloid binding. And we can see in this Alzheimer's patient compared to the normal, there's a higher amount of amyloid in this brain. Now, what are the limitations of this technology? Well, one interesting part that I have noted on the slide here is by the scanning, we see amyloid beginning to accumulate in the brain 20 years before dementia starts. So that was a surprise. No one knew that this, you know, process was starting 20 years before the dementia starts, which gives us a long time to intervene, you know, to prevent the dementia from starting. So that's good. A limitation of this technology is that if we take normal, cognitively normal 70-year-olds and do an amyloid PET scan, a third of them will have amyloid accumulated in the brain. So we wouldn't say they have Alzheimer's disease clinically. Cognitively, they're normal. So the scan is not really that helpful in that situation. And likewise, we have patients that we think by every criteria have Alzheimer's disease, but 5 or 10% of them, we can't see amyloid on the amyloid PET scan. So it doesn't mean they don't have Alzheimer's. So because of those limitations, Medicare and insurance companies will not pay for this scan, because they're saying, what good is this information? Is it going to change your therapy? Is it going to change your diagnosis? Not really. It costs about $4,000, so a few times a month at Stanford, we will have patients and families pay for it themselves, and we'll offer it. You know, some people just want to know what their amyloid PET scan looks like, and for $4,000, we'll do the scan. But right now, third parties are not paying for it. And then the tau PET scan, similar idea, a radionuclide tracer is injected in the vein, goes up to the brain, and this time it sticks to those tau accumulations rather than the amyloid accumulations. And again, the Alzheimer's patient has a higher levels of these tau accumulations. This is still in the research mode. It's not available clinically. I think it will be at some point, but we probably need more accuracy in this to help us make diagnoses. Now, if you're in our, just to go back to here, if you're in our one of our trials at Stanford, including our Alzheimer's Disease Research Center trial, you'll end up getting an amyloid PET scan. So these are commonly done in trials. We just don't do them for regular clinic visits. The future, though, is really, we want to know how the brain's functioning. And this is another project that Dr. Mike Graches is doing. This is imaging brain circuit function. So on the left, we have a healthy elderly person, and on the right, we have somebody with early Alzheimer's. Those orange areas there are the circuits in the brain that are lighting up orange, and they're active in memory function. And we can see that the early Alzheimer's patient has lost those orange circuits, and they've lost memory function. And Mike Graches's group at Stanford was the first in the world to apply this kind of circuit imaging to any neurologic disease, and he picked Alzheimer's as the first one to work on. So this was the first demonstration of the world of a living patient and actually imaging their circuit functioning in their brain. And that's a huge breakthrough, because it's the dream of every psychiatrist, neurologist, and neurosurgeon to have a scan that tells us how your circuits are working, right? We can see amyloid or tau accumulating, but that doesn't tell us how the brain's working. It just says something's accumulating, right? We want to know how these circuits are working in all disorders, basically, whether it's autism or depression. Different circuits are affected in the brain, and if we could visualize that circuit function, we could make our diagnoses more accurate, and we could follow therapies. This is not clinically available yet, but it's a glimpse for you of what we hope the future will be when you come to a cutting-edge neurology clinic. You'll come for a circuit examination by one of these scans, and we think it'll help our Alzheimer efforts quite a bit. Let's go into the therapeutic area now. We covered what Alzheimer's and dementia is, how we assess patients that come to our clinic. And then we make a diagnosis of Alzheimer's. What can we do about it? We can talk about FDA-approved therapies first. These are drugs, and I'm mentioning them there by their generic names and by the brand names in parentheses. And this is a picture of a synaptic connection. And these synaptic connections work by one neuron up above releasing what we call neurotransmitters, neurochemicals, releasing them across that connection, and then they get that next neuron to fire its message. And so that's how messages between the neurons are transmitted through these neurochemicals. And what these drugs do is help boost the levels of those neurochemicals a little bit, and they can improve that synaptic function a little bit. But they don't, however, unfortunately, slow the loss of those synapses. And that's what's happening in Alzheimer's and these other neurodegenerative diseases. So they don't slow progression, they don't delay onset, they can help cognitive function a little bit, and so we try them in all our patients. Some patients have a pretty good response. I had one patient who no longer could make coffee, and that was his job in the morning that his wife gave him, and then we started him on one of these drugs, and a couple months later, his wife reported he's making the coffee again. So you get some good responses like that. Other people have no response. We can't predict ahead of time who will respond, so we try everybody on these medications. There are two categories. One is the upper three there, and then memantine, the brand name's Namenda, is the second category, only one drug in that category, and it works a slightly different way, but same idea, supporting this function at the synapse there. These drugs have been around for a while. Now there's a more recent drug, Namzaric, that I've listed on the bottom, and I updated this slide. It's not in your handout there. Don't worry, there are very few number of updates here. You don't have to take many notes. And many of our families are saying, hey, what about this new drug, right? And unfortunately, it's not really a new drug. It's just a combination of two of the old ones. You can see there, the donepezil and the memantine. It's a combo drug. And when in medicine, sometimes companies will put two drugs together because we often combine one of the drugs from that first category with memantine. We have many of our patients on both drugs. So a company just made a pill or capsule that contains both, has a new name, but unfortunately it's not a new drug for Alzheimer's. I generally don't like combination drugs. I would never start two drugs at the same time because if somebody has a side effect, I don't know which drug's causing the side effect. I don't want to be in that position. So typically we'll start one drug from that upper box, one of those three drugs. We'll start that first, see how the patient's doing for several months. Many of them we have to go up gradually on the dose. If everything's okay and if the patient's appropriate, then we can consider adding the second one. Then if the side effect starts, then we know it was the second one, right? And we can't go with the second one, we'll leave them on the first. If I were to start somebody on a combo from day one and they have a side effect, we don't know what to do, right? And then when they're separate, I can adjust the dose of each one separately. That combination, I can't adjust the doses separately. So we have 8 neurologists at Stanford taking in our memory disorders clinic. None of us are using that new one, but it's you need to know about it because people will say there's a new drug for Alzheimer's. Okay, let's talk about prevention strategies, and we'll get back to the drugs in the pipeline. And our families ask us about these four areas quite a bit: cognitive exercise, sleep, dietary strategies, and physical exercise. So everybody here is in the dementia and Alzheimer's field professionally. I know some of you have family members affected, so we all have to know about these. There are new data on all of these every month, and part of my job is to keep up with what's going on, claims, counterclaims, debates, arguments, controversies, etc. Let's start off with the brain exercises, sitting at your computer, doing brain exercises. Very, very controversial area, very big industry with lots of money made selling these. What's the latest? Now, 2 years ago or 3 years ago now, there was a big meeting at Stanford to address the controversy of whether these brain games have any usefulness or not. And you can read it there. 69 scientists at Stanford University and other institutions issued a statement that the scientific track record does not support the claims that so-called brain games actually help older adults boost their mental powers. And more recently, there was a review published just last year in 2016 where they reviewed 13 studies that have been published in this area in healthy aged people. Most of these studies are non-Alzheimer's patients, but healthy aged, to see if we can improve age-related cognition. And they found that 11 of 13 of these studies found an improved effect on what we call executive function. It's the ability to multitask, and we use executive function when we're on these games. And so people do accept that whatever cognitive function we use to play a game, that will get better, that particular function. The big controversy is, though, is whether there's what we call transference or generalization to other cognitive functions, because that would be the importance of a therapy, right? If the only thing that the game allows you to do is get better at the game or identical similar tasks on a computer, is it worth an hour or more a day for that if you're just as likely to lose your car when you park it or not pay your bill or leave the stove on, right? And so that's where the controversy is. What's the evidence that there's a transfer effect? The psychologists use the term transfer, or we can say generalization. And there's also been some research on seeing if these brain exercises could reduce the odds of progressing from MCI to an actual dementia, and we really don't know. We don't have any evidence for that. So not a lot of supportive data, although more recently in the past year, I'm starting to see some small studies having some hints that there may be some degree of generalization. So I haven't completely eliminated this in my mind, that there's something useful here, but we have minimal data on it. This is some of the best data for a possibility of generalization from Adam Ghazali's group up at UCSF. It was published in 2013, and they continue to work on it. And this is an example of how these work. So this is a research-based brain exercise game that they gave their subjects. These were people with just age-related cognitive impairment. And they divided the group of volunteers into three categories. The first third did a single task. Their job, this was done on a laptop, keep the car on the road. The second group had symbols flash up on the screen, and the symbols said you had to do something with a lever with your hand. It's just a symbol meant a command, and you had to respond to that command. But that's the only thing you needed to worry about. The third group had the hardest job. They had to do both at the same time. They had to multitask. They had to keep the car on the road and respond to the symbol commands. So they had them do this 1 hour a day, three times a week for a month. That was the training period. Then they came back at the six-month time point, and they tested working memory, which was not involved in playing the game, right? So a separate cognitive task was tested here to see if playing that game helped memory, but memory was not involved in the game. And they did find a significant improvement in working memory. So this was published in a very prominent journal, Nature, because it was really one of the first well-done studies showing some generalization effect, right? They played this game and their working memory got a little bit better. But as Adam Ghazali points out, this is done in a research laboratory with a research game. Who knows how it would apply to us regular people at home sitting on a computer. And they're working on developing a commercial version on this, but I'm not aware of it being out yet. So there may be something to brain exercises. We'll have to wait and see. My guess, biologically speaking, is that I think it's important, what I tell my patients' families, to be cognitively engaged. I use the word engaged. And be on a mission or have a passion. My guess is that these cognitive activities have a more powerful effect on the brain if there's a mission or a passion or a purpose. And it's probably hard to capture that on a brain, sitting at a computer doing a brain exercise. I'm just speculating there. We'll see what this field shows. Let's get to diet. 18 studies reviewed here, and we're mainly talking about so-called Mediterranean diet. These aren't real strict or crazy diets. Mediterranean meaning not no meat, but less meat, more whole grains, more fish, more vegetables, not big hits of sugar, etc. And we do get some overall, to review the entire literature, about a 20% risk reduction in the risk of coming down with a dementia over a given time period. So being on a Mediterranean diet is associated with lower risk of dementia by about 20% if I put all the studies together. And that's what we call an association study or an epidemiological study, right? It's not cause and effect necessarily. It just means that people on a Mediterranean diet are associated with a lower risk of dementia, but it's possible that people on a Mediterranean diet are doing something else we don't know about, and it's the something else that's reducing their dementia risk, right? So we have to distinguish between a cause and effect research and association research, and 99% of the research that you read about in the media are associations, right? So we have to have a critical perspective. But the ideal trial that we'd like to have is what we call a randomized prospective trial. That's how we get a cause and effect. So we take this half of the room and we say, you go on a Mediterranean diet for the next 5 years, be strict about it, we're going to monitor you, and then come back and we'll do your cognitive testing. This half of the room, who's identically the same every other way, smoking rates, drinking rates, exercise rates, because we randomized you, right? Everything else averages out the same. The only difference is that this half of the room has volunteered to eat only at Burger King and McDonald's for the next 5 years, and then come back and we'll do your cognitive studies. That's how you do a randomized prospective trial, but you can see that's not an easy trial to do. And that's why we don't have those. Now, I did find one that I didn't add on here that was done in Spain just recently, where they did this prospective. It wasn't quite as strict. They didn't have to eat at Burger King, McDonald's. But one half were on a pretty strict Mediterranean diet, supplemented with extra doses of olive oil. They thought that was an important enhancement of the Mediterranean diet. So done prospectively, and there was a difference in cognition at the end of about 5 years. So that's the only big, well-done, prospective, randomized trial with Mediterranean diet. So, you know, we'll keep learning about this, but in the meantime, maybe it's not a bad thing to try to eat a healthy diet. Not easy. That picture there just meant to show that the person on the Western diet's brain compared to the Mediterranean diet, that brain toward the right is a little bit shrunken compared to the brain on the left. So that Western diet is associated with a little bit of brain shrinkage, which we probably want to try to avoid. What about diets, supplements? Supplements are one of the favorite questions in the clinic, because it would be really awesome if you could just go to GNC and take something and reduce your risk of Alzheimer's, and I wish we could. I follow this closely because I'm asked about it continuously every day. Omega-3 fatty acids, extensive literature, a lot of interest, you know, fish oil. 5 out of 6 Alzheimer's studies of dosing people with Alzheimer's, no effect on cognition, except for one study that showed a small effect in the mild Alzheimer's. So I guess overall, not much evidence that it would help in actual Alzheimer's. Mild cognitive impairment, 4 out of 5 small studies showed some mild improvement in cognition, but again, with small studies, we're careful. No definitive conclusion here. And then finally, in normal cognitive aging, 3 out of 3 studies, no effect whatsoever. I don't like to take people's hope away. Fish oil or omega-3 fatty acids could be somewhat helpful. If there's no harm, it's okay. Now, you want to talk to your main doctor, though. If you're on Coumadin, for example, and you take high doses of these, it could affect Coumadin, your bleeding levels, for example. So again, you want to coordinate with your primary physician. Vitamin E, that's been in and out of fashion over the past 20 years. It helps prevent dementia. It doesn't. It does. It doesn't. So the bottom line is, if we look at the well-done studies, one that just came out this year called PreAdvise, there's really no great evidence for vitamin E lowering the odds of getting dementia. We don't generally recommend it. Vitamin D, the normal levels are the 20 to 40 nanograms per mil. Many of your primary care physicians might be checking this. It's supposed to, if you avoid low levels, it might be helpful in terms of cancer reduction, et cetera. There are some studies emerging that people with low D, that's less than 10, so very low, might be at about a 2-fold risk of getting a dementia. And then there were 3 small interventional studies of giving people doses of vitamin D to see if they could improve executive function. These were in aged people, some very small effects. But I don't think these are large enough studies to to recommend taking extra doses of vitamin D, but my take-home lesson is I'd rather not be really low. So I wouldn't mind having my level checked by my primary care physician, and if it were really low, and if it, plus, especially if I thought I were some increased risk for Alzheimer's, my parent has it, my sibling has it, I want to avoid being low, but taking big doses, we don't have evidence that it would help. Let's go on to sleep. If people with sleep disordered breathing, these are the significant episodes of disordered breathing where in a sleep lab we'd see your blood oxygen levels take a big dip. If you're a heavy snorer, if a family member or spouse has identified you as that, we'll often send you for a sleep study to see if you're having these oxygen dips. Because if you're in that category, you're about a twofold risk of getting a dementia. I thought this study was interesting, done out of Wash U, where they measured amyloid levels in the spinal fluid during the night. So on your y-axis there, we have amyloid levels. On the x-axis, those numbers are small. That's the time during the night. And that blue shaded area is the time for sleep. And one group, they were checking their amyloid levels in their spinal fluid. And then the group that had a disrupted sleep, they were woken up every 2 hours. In the morning there, in the red circle, their amyloid levels remained high. The group that got the uninterrupted, normal sleep, their amyloid levels came down in the morning. So there's a theory that our brains work to clear amyloid during the night, especially toward the end of the sleep in the morning, and that's why people that have disrupted sleep might be at higher risk for Alzheimer's. More is coming out on this. This is another study with sleep, looking again at the amyloid PET scans, the orange and the yellow. The orange are higher levels of amyloid, and the people that have sleep less than 6 hours per night, higher levels of amyloid accumulation, greater than 7 hours, lower levels of amyloid. But we don't have prospective trials. It's hard to take this half of the room, you sleep for more than 7 hours, you sleep for less than six, and come back later and get your amyloid scan, right? We try to get good sleep anyway. Exercise, I'm reviewing many studies here. I'm just going to give you the bottom line of exercise. And we call moderate levels of exercise are defined typically by as 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week, at a moderate level, meaning in a normal temperature, after about 10 minutes, you'd start to break a sweat. It's about 65% of your maximum predicted heart rate if you want to take your pulse. And there's a little formula you can see on the websites for your age. You have a maximum predicted heart rate. So these aren't massive levels of exercise. They're ones that if your heart's okay and if your knees are okay, it's a brisk walk, basically, that one can do. The bottom line with many studies is that people who get these levels of exercise have a 40% reduced risk of coming down with a dementia. And here, this is an example of some of the mechanisms of exercise. Again, we're going back to these amyloid PET scans. And we have a bar graph there. We have the APOE4 negative, people that don't have the high-risk gene. That high-risk gene encourages the brain to accumulate amyloid as one of its mechanisms anyway. And the APOE4 negative, people that don't have the high-risk gene have the low levels of amyloid, whether they're non-exercisers or exercisers. If we take the high-risk gene people, the E4 positive, the non-exercisers have high levels of amyloid on the brain PET scan, but look what happens to the people with the high-risk gene that exercise. They completely wiped out the gene's effect on accumulating amyloid. So we've all been told we can't do anything about our genes, but in this case, the people who had the high-risk gene, when they exercised, they negated that gene's effect on accumulating amyloid in the brain. So it's a very powerful effect, potentially, on exercise. This is shrinkage of the hippocampus. They did a controlled prospective trial. People walked briskly in the exercise group. The other people were more passive. And they looked at a hippocampus, shown in yellow, important part of the brain for memory. It shrinks, loses 1% or 2% of the volume per year. They looked at 6 months and 1 year. The red line were the non-walkers, so they're losing volume at 6 months and 1 year. But then when they looked at the people that were walking, their hippocampus actually got a little larger. They thought they were going to try to reduce the shrinkage rate by exercising, but the exercise effect was so powerful that the hippocampus got larger. That's a very, very powerful effect of exercise. And if we sum up all the well-done trials on applying the treatment of exercise to people that actually have a dementia, right? And it's, when one looks at all the trials done, it's called a meta-analysis, because you can always cite one trial that favors what you're saying or cite one trial that's against it. And a meta-analysis is an attempt to cite every trial, every well-done trial that's been done on the topic, regardless of its outcome, put them all together and see what the net effect is of all the research in the world on this question. And so when those bars shift to the right, that means there was a positive effect, meaning improved cognition of exercise in a dementia person. And when the bar shifts to the left, that would be a negative effect. Dementia gets, cognition gets worse. And then at the very bottom in the red rectangle that I put there, we get a net effect, mathematically counted, calculated, and it's shifted to the right by a statistically significant amount. So this means if one takes all the well-done exercise studies of the world in dementia patients, there's a positive effect on cognition. And number two, the second point here is that the amount of improvement in cognitive function is greater than the amount of improvement we see with the FDA-approved drugs. So that's really important. I'm going to even say that a second time. The improvement caused by exercise in a demented person is greater than the improvement caused by the FDA-approved drugs, right? Now, not everyone can exercise. Our treatments are individualized. Everybody is an individual, right? But you, as a practitioner or somebody in the field, you can you need to know that fact, right? And most people don't know that fact, right? So I share this with all of our patients in our clinic. Could you imagine coming to a physician who would tell you about the second best treatment, the drugs, and not tell you about the best treatment, the exercise? Wouldn't that be a crazy clinic visit? I think so, but anyway, that's what the data is telling us. Okay, I want to wrap up in the next couple minutes here. This exercise effect is a lifelong issue. For those of you with kids or grandchildren, it's just shown over and over again. If you measure fitness, aerobic fitness in a child, that correlates with mathematical and verbal scores. There's really not much question to that. And when they do brain scans on these kids, the parts of the brain that are important for verbal ability and math ability are slightly larger in the kids that have high aerobic fitness. Perhaps one of the best gifts that one can give a child is aerobic fitness. In Sweden, everyone during the 60s and 70s was drafted, and at age 18, everybody had an aerobic fitness test, and then they followed them for 40 years. The ones in the low fitness category at age 18, later on in their older age, were 2.5 likely to get dementia when they were out of shape at age 18. So again, this might be a lifelong effect. So to summarize, I think our best data, it's actually both the best done data, because these are prospective trials in exercise. It's hard to do prospective trials in these other areas. And the highest effect size is in exercise. But I think the future is to think that, well, I think all of these are important, right? And there are three big trials going on in Europe now. One's a Finnish study, it has this acronym FINGER, where they're combining physical exercise, diet, and cognitive engagement. Because putting everything together might be even more powerful. It's a more natural way of going at things. I separated the things out because scientifically we want to think about each part as carefully and precise as we can, but maybe in real life we should be doing all of these. My only point to my patients are, if I were going to take an hour a day and do something, because most of my patients prefer sitting in front of the computer for an hour and won't exercise, right? And when you have this knowledge, you realize how crazy that is. If you're going to devote an hour a day to not getting dementia, and you choose to sit in front of a computer rather than taking a brisk walk for 30 minutes, assuming you can walk safely, not everyone can, that's interesting. So my patients know, what's the first question I'll ask you when I see you next visit? Tell me about the exercise, right? Okay, current trials. You read about these in the news, creating antibodies whose intent is to go into that brain and clear out the amyloid, shown in the bright colors there again. We've had a number of the advanced phase 3 trials in mild to moderate Alzheimer's. So unfortunately, those have failed. The theory is that maybe it's too late in that stage of Alzheimer's, and so those trials have shifted now to much earlier stages, even before the dementia starts or in very early stages of dementia, and we're 2 and 3 and 4 years away from knowing if those trials will work. Hopefully they will. And then we have in earlier stages antibodies against the tau protein, again, to try to clear it out, and those are in earlier phase 1 and 2 trials, so we don't know yet. We do both kinds of those trials at Stanford, they're done at UCSF, so they're fairly common trials to do. I think both of these are good approaches, and hopefully they'll have some effects. I was asked quite a bit about this ultrasound for Alzheimer's treatment. This came out of Australia. They applied ultrasound to the brain, and they did this in mice. I have a picture of a human here, but this was done in mice, and those green bunches there are amyloid plaques, and the mice that got the ultrasound treatment had a reduced number of amyloid plaques. The theory here is that the ultrasound loosens up the blood-brain barrier. That's the membrane that protects the brain. And when it loosens up the blood-brain barrier, parts of the immune system can go in and maybe clear out some of that amyloid. That's the theory. So they've started a phase 1 trial in humans just looking for safety, because is that safe in a human to affect your blood-brain barrier? We don't know. But this is not available clinically. I'm not aware of where, if any, trials are being done in the U.S., but just to know about that, because people ask about it. This, you may have heard about this work at Stanford, the discovery of Antoni Weiss-Corey and Tom Randall's group. If you take blood from a young mouse and inject it into an old mouse, the brain will recover some of its age-related degeneration. If you inject that blood from a young mouse into an Alzheimer's mouse, it'll recover some of those synaptic connections that were lost in the Alzheimer's mice. So now their goal is to figure out what's so good about that young blood. What component in that young blood do we want to get our hands on? Right? And they're getting close to answering that. We don't know yet. In the meantime, we've done a phase 1 trial at Stanford with Alzheimer's patients. We gave them blood from young people through the Stanford Blood Bank, and we don't have results yet. It was an initial phase 1 safety trial, and we'll see what happens with that. This is our own, my group's effort. We've developed a drug that attacks both amyloid mechanisms and tau mechanisms and inflammation mechanisms all at the same time. It's done extremely well in mouse studies, and our goal has been to get it in humans, which is very difficult to do. Most of us in the university setting work really hard to get something to work in a mouse. It takes years to get something to work in a mouse. We'll publish it in a paper, we'll get promoted, and that's it, unfortunately. But when you're taking care of people with this, it's not good enough, right? I'm embarrassed that 20 years later, I'm going to my memory disorders clinic and I don't have a cure, right? That's not great. So my team's dedicated itself to really getting things in people. Very unusual for a neurologist to go from a mouse and get something into people. What we've done it, we've gotten through, and the story's been so complicated and difficult that we ended up being on the cover of Time magazine just for the effort. I wish it was because the drug worked. We don't know that yet, but just for the effort. And this kind of gives you an idea. The image on the left is a neuron in the hippocampus of a mouse. In this case, the humans ones look the same way. You get these beautiful branches, and those little dots along those branches are the spines that are the heart and soul of the synapse. The spines are shown blown up in the bottom panel there. The middle image is from an Alzheimer's mouse. Those beautiful connections are withered like a dying tree, losing those connections in that Alzheimer's mouse that has impaired memory. And we give our drug and we can bring those branches back. We can bring those connections back in a very powerful way, even in very late stage Alzheimer mice. So how do you get that into a person? This is the valley of death that we often talk about. We can do these initial studies on the left there in a university laboratory. We can get them to mice. And on the other end, Big Pharma does these big phase 3 trials really well. They're set up to do that. That might be with 2,000 patients. But they're risk adverse for good reason. There have been many failures. So they say, hey, that sounds great. Let us know how the phase 2 trial goes. We don't do phase two trials typically in the university, right? So who's going to do that? So it gets called the valley of death. How do you cross that? And so we started our own company to do that. And we've finished phase one, and we're just starting our phase two. This is the phase one stage. And this is the first time a human being takes your drug. It's really a dramatic, scary moment. I've been working with mice for many years, and this is an entirely new chemical, never been in a human being before, and it looked okay in the mice. We test it very formally in rats and dogs for safety under FDA guidelines, and then the FDA approves each of these steps. But then there's going to be one day where the first human being, and the phase one human trials with normal people with normal cognition, not Alzheimer's, the FDA requires that your first testing is in so-called normal people. But there is that one day where that first human being takes your drug for the first time. And we do our best with the animals to look at safety, but you never know. And so this is done in a center, in a hospital, and the subjects are surrounded continuously by doctors and nurses and monitored intensely. I was just in the background watching, and fortunately it went well. We had 72 subjects in this trial. There, we didn't have any major side effects. And that allowed us really to move on to a phase 2A trial in Alzheimer's patients. We can move a little faster in Europe. And so we're just starting in the last couple of months to screen patients for this phase, what we call a phase 2A trial in Alzheimer's. So we've gone from basic mechanism to the neurons growing in a dish to mice. And everybody in their mouse paper says this could be a treatment in humans someday. That's not good enough. We brought it into humans. And this will take about 2 years to complete this trial. If we get good trends, then it would go on to a phase three larger trial. That's the strategy here. And finally, this is our new clinic center at Stanford Neuroscience Health Center, where we have five levels here of neurologists and neurosurgeons and the latest in neuroimaging. And the goal in this field is really, we're not quite there yet, but the goal here would be when you're age 30 or 40 or 50, depending on your family history, et cetera, we would do a DNA test, a blood test, a brain scan, and customize for you as an individual whether or not you're going to get dementia and what your odds are at each age. You might get a result back saying, hey, by age 85, you have less than a 1% chance of getting a dementia. You don't need to take anything. Or we might say, unfortunately, by age 65, you have a 90% chance of coming down with a dementia. Here are the options. And hopefully at that point, we'll have drugs and other therapies that we start before the dementia starts, right? Just like getting a colonoscopy at age 50. You should be getting your brain checked at a certain age, too. And we're developing the technologies for those, and we're in a beautiful setup to apply those. So the goal is to be able to do the assessment and then have the therapies available for, you know, precision health is what we call it. Precision health designed to the individual to keep them dementia-free, but in the meantime, we'll keep doing our best. So I will stop there. I think we have a few minutes for questions, about 5 minutes for questions. Thank you.
What we thought we would do is take a couple of the questions that had some common themes. And then what we're going to do is work with our communications team, and we're going to answer these questions for you and put them up on some of our social media and websites so that you'll be able to go back and get to some of the answers. But some of the common questions that we had were around some of the, you talked a lot about the pharmacologic interventions. What kind of advice do you have for people who are looking for some of those non-pharmacologic interventions to some of the more challenging symptoms that come with Alzheimer's disease or related dementia?
You mean, like, say, some of the behavioral symptoms?
Yes, some of the behavioral symptoms.
Yeah, this is a tough area in the Alzheimer's field. So if I understand the question correctly, is besides having various areas of cognitive impairment, memory, et cetera, as many of you know, our patients can get behavioral symptoms, aggressiveness, et cetera, that can make them very difficult to provide care for. And they were very limited in the medications, right? And we try to use behavioral therapy in those cases, which is not easy. And there is no easy answer on the medications because they're all risky. Mm-hmm. Various kinds of medications in the neuroleptic category are used. They all have certain risks in the dementia population. And at Stanford, we have a whole separate neuropsychiatry team that deals more with the behavioral issues. And the geropsychiatrists are actually more experienced in behavioral issues than I would be as a neurologist.
Okay, great. You know, you talked about, I think, one of my favorite questions that I get, and you answered it in the beginning, and that's that difference between Alzheimer's disease and dementia. Right. Tell us why that's important, that we understand the difference between those. Why is it important for us to think about the difference?
Yeah, why is it important to know the difference between Alzheimer's and dementia? Well, the meanings are so much different, right? Dementia, there are 20 or so causes of dementia. And I think when many patients see their initial provider who's not trained in the area of dementia, they'll often just be diagnosed with a dementia. But that's like saying you have heart disease. I mean, you want a more specific diagnosis than heart disease. Do you have congestive heart failure? Do you have coronary artery disease? Do you have atrial fibrillation? That's a diagnosis, right? So dementia, to me, is almost, it's not a diagnosis. Do you have Alzheimer's? Do you have Lewy body? Do you have vascular dementia? That's the diagnosis you need to hear. The practical importance of that is you may want to be in a trial, right? So there are separate trials for Alzheimer's, vascular dementia, Lewy body. So you need a specific diagnosis.
And, you know, thinking about that, one of the questions that I saw, and it's something I think about, what advice would you give to a friend or a family member if I was concerned about my memory and having a difficult time in looking at getting that diagnosis? Why is diagnosis so important? What would you tell me?
Yeah, I think why is diagnosis important? We don't want to miss anything we can easily fix, right? Could you imagine having a memory problem because your B12 is low and then waiting another 5 years till your brain damage is even worse? And it could have been fixed. So one needs that medical assessment early on so that we don't miss things we could readily address.
And has there been any studying looking at how long, somebody asked about how long with these exercise programs before we would see any sort of results? The same sort of question around the Mediterranean diet.
Right, right. How long before we see a benefit? The exercise studies are generally done roughly at about for 6 months. Treatment would be a typical duration. So I would expect at least 6 months to see an effect, yep. Something on that order. The Mediterranean diet may be longer, a year or so. Going on a Mediterranean diet, I think the largest effect there may be reducing risk for dementia. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't expect to see an improved cognition necessarily. The mm-hmm. effect may be too small.
And you talked a lot about amyloid. Somebody asked, what is amyloid?
Right, what is amyloid? It's confusing. So amyloid really is that fragment of a protein that clumps together, and that clump of that abnormal fragment is amyloid.
And sort of along that line, someone else asked the question, so we've heard a lot about the targets with amyloid and both the tau. Are there other things that are being focused on that you're aware of in some of the research?
Right, so yeah, many of the therapeutic targets have evolved around the amyloid and the tau. Are there others? Yes, a third category that's really emerging is inflammation mechanisms. As we age, our entire body has a little more inflammation, including our brain. And in these diseases, especially Alzheimer's, but some of the other neurodegenerative diseases, we get more and more inflammatory mechanisms in our brain. So people are going after that inflammation as part of therapeutics.
And is there any evidence that cognitive rehabilitation in patients with MCI or early Alzheimer's disease has any benefit?
Yeah, is there evidence for cognitive rehabilitation? There's some evidence, you know, that borders, I think cognitive rehab borders on cognitive exercise, mm-hmm. right? And so there might be some mild effects, there could be some evidence there, but I would prioritize physical exercise.
All right, so we're gonna end with the impossible question for you to answer,
right.
But it's one that's gonna get us all thinking about why talking about research is so important. Dr. Edgerly mentioned this morning in her opening remarks, we've had some recent wins with NIH funding, and we know that we are on the right track towards an effective treatment, but we also know we can't stop with the $1.4 billion. We've got a long way to go. In your opinion, how close do you think we are to an effective treatment?
How close are we to an effective treatment? I think the effective treatments will come in increments, right? Mm-hmm. So we'll have, I think, maybe in 3 or 4 years, maybe one of these antibody trials will show, we see a slope going down of cognition getting worse if we have Alzheimer's. That slope will go down less steeply, mm-hmm. and that'll be mm-hmm. a big success.
Yeah.
But it's still going down, right? Yeah. That's what I mean by incremental. Then we'll need a therapy where it stops it from going down, right? And so this will evolve over 5, 10, 15 years, something like that. But you reminded me, I left out my last couple slides. We have a table out there, this importance of research.
Absolutely.
Our Alzheimer's Disease Research Center at Stanford is enrolling normal volunteers and people at all stages, MCI, Alzheimer's, Lewy body dementia, different kinds of dementias, to participate, come in and get a cognitive exam, some imaging, some blood work, and then we'll follow you over time. And there are a number of benefits. We have classes for people. We have support groups. We're starting a Tai Chi and yoga groups. So a lot of support for our families that enroll in mm-hmm. these. We're collecting information on you. It's not meant to be a clinical assessment, but if we find something we're concerned about, we'll let you know that you need to see a clinical neurologist where you live or at Stanford to get that taken care of. So many benefits for enrolling. Maybe the most important is those enrollments are helping us to move the field forward.
Absolutely.
And we're lucky that we have an NIH-funded center right here in our backyard. I mean, one at Stanford, there's one at UCSF. So please participate if you're interested. And our team is at the table right there for questions.
Yeah, we know that funding is the number one problem in an effective treatment or cure. The second is participation in all of these amazing trials that are happening. So you can additionally get information through clinical trials, through Trial Match, which is a clinical trial matching service. You have information about that in your packet as well. And we encourage you to sign that card today, give it to one of our staff. Because it is what's going to help us move the needle. So as you can imagine, there were tons of questions, so I tried to pick the ones that there were multiple of so we could try and meet some needs there. But we're going to do a good job of trying to answer these with some of our experts in the field and at the Alzheimer's Association and get these posted on social media for you so that you can kind of see the expert panels. And I want to thank you, Dr. Longo,
thank
for
you.
Sharing your day with us today.
Thank you.